to introduce Ezequiel Barbosa from Minas Gerais, who is talking about the compactness of minimal hypersurfaces.
Oh, right, thank you. David, please. All right. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for all the support to participate of this event, especially José Escobar for the invitation. And to say that, for me, it's a great pleasure to be here, especially in this colloquium. Okay, so thank you so much for that. I will talk about today on compactness results. Actually, I'm very interested in some existence results, and some of these existence results can be obtained using some kind of compactness results. And so today I just want to present some existence results related to a kind of problem I'm very interested in, and the compactness, kind of compactness result that are involved in some recent results on this. Okay, so let's get started considering a closed n plus one dimensional manifold, Riemannian smooth manifold, and a closed hypersurface in this manifold. Okay, so this hypersurface will be called the minimal hypersurface if its mean curvature is zero. Of course, I'm considering here a closed manifold, but you can consider manifolds with boundary, and we can consider minimal hypersurface with free boundary, and you have more general setting to be considered, okay? So the question is, do minimal hypersurfaces exist? And of course, we can take some talks early and see that we can find examples of minimal hypersurfaces in some manifolds. But in this context here, let me just consider this question and remember that results due to Pitts and Schoen-Simon, you can prove that, yes, there exist closed embedded minimal hypersurfaces and Riemannian manifolds with dimension between 3 and 7. Of course, you can obtain more general results when you allow singularities, okay? So this result, as David was talking about in a few minutes ago, you can prove using the minimax procedure. And just refreshing here, we consider the sweepouts on this manifold and consider the maximum area of the elements in this sweepout, and then you consider all the possible sweepouts, actually homotopically equivalent the sweepouts, and then you take the infimum of the areas, the maximum areas, and then this will give you a minimal hypersurface. Okay, so what is interesting here is after you prove yes that exists minimal hypersurface, you want to know now what kind, well, more information about these minimal hypersurfaces. For example, you want to know about the topology, the geometry, the index, the area, or whatever. So in the S3, if you consider any metric on the S3, you can find a sphere, as David was talking about a few minutes ago. And you can, in fact, control the topology of this minimax surface. You can control the topology in the following way. Actually, if you consider a surface that is a Higa surface, then you can produce a sweep out with this surface being an element of the sweep out. And then you consider all the homotopically equivalent sweep outs of this first sweep out. And then you take the minimax, the width, and then you produce a minimax surface and the with a possibility with multiplicities. And then the genus of this minimax minimal surface is controlled by the genus of this Higgard surface. And then in the case of the sphere, you can obtain a minimal sphere on this S3. So using a kind of compactness result, I will talk about this in a few minutes, Brian White proved that you can find not just only a sphere, you can find a torus as well. But here, he is assuming this condition, the Ricci curvature. The Ricci has to be positive, and then you will find a torus. So to prove this, Brian White used a degree theory, and this compactness result due to Choi Chen, I will present here this in a few minutes. It's very important. And so this is just an example where an existence result is obtained using a kind of compactness result. Okay, so by compactness result, I mean it's especially for this case of minimal surface or hypersurfaces, is you get a sequence of minimal hypersurface satisfying some condition, and then you can up to subsequence get that the sequence is converging in some sense. Okay, so using this kind of result, you can prove some existence results. Let me make this question here now. After you prove that there exists an X sphere and a torus, now you can make this question. Is it possible to find a minimal surface in S3 with a metric with positive Ricci curvature for any genus? So this is just a question, okay? So let me present two examples where this is true. Of course, in S3 with the canonical sphere, you can find embedded minimal surface of every genus. This was proved by Lanson. And if you consider on the S3 Birger metrics, you can find as well minimal embedded surface with any genus. Okay? So now, this Marx and Neves result related to, of course, Yao's conjecture, but it's somehow answering this question because they proved that on a manifold with positive Ricci curvature tensor and dimension between 3 and 7, you can find infinitely many smooth closed embedded minimal hypersurfaces. And so if you get infinitely many minimal hypersurfaces, you want to know more information about this minimal hypersurfaces. In this case, let's consider three-dimensional case. We got the result due to Yang Yao that if you have a two-dimensional surface, then the first eigenvalue of the Laplacian operator times the area is less than or equal to 8 pi times g plus 1. And another result due to Choi Wang is this is not important to stay on. This is Laplace operator. So this result due to Shoi Wang says the following: if you consider as a minimal hypersurface in a closed manifold, then the first, of course, you consider the Ricci curvature bounded by a positive constant, then the first eigenvalue of a minimal hypersurface is greater than or equal to k over 2. So using these two results, we can obtain that if the area of the minimal surfaces produced by Marques and Neves are going to infinite, then the genus is going to infinite. And so you somehow can answer this this question here, at least for, I mean, you are not constructing a minimal surface with any kind of genus, but for genus going to infinity. Okay, so, but now, of course, you don't have this information here. As far as I know, we don't know if the area of the minimax surfaces produced by Marques and Neves result is going to infinity. So we cannot obtain that the genus is going to infinity. So but for bumpy metric, is it possible to obtain this using, again, a compactness, kind of compactness result? And bumpy metric, let me just remember this here. So a metric G on M is called bumpy if any closed embedded minimal hypersurface sigma has no non-trivial Jacob fields. I mean, a Jacob field is just a function here satisfying this equation here, H. Square equal to zero. So if you are considering a three-manifold with a bumpy metric with positive Ricci curvature, then the minimal surfaces constructed by Marques and Neves has index, has genus goes to infinity. And the proof is simple using this compactness result proved by Cody Minicozzi. For bumpy metrics, if you fix a set of minimal surfaces with area bound and genus bound, then the set has to be finite. And so if you apply this to, if you consider positive Ricci curvature, then if the genus is bounded, you get with these two results, the area is bounded. And then genus bounded and area bounded, the set of the minimal surface has to be finite. But the Marques and Neves result is saying that this, the set of minimal surfaces is not finite. And so this compactness result here can be used again to prove an existence result. Okay. And so let me tell you one more thing about the minimal surface. This is the index. If you consider the result proved by Marx and Neves that David mentioned here, you can prove that there exists index one minimal surface. But what about the index two or more high index? At least in the canonical sphere, you get a minimal surface with index going to infinity, just because you can use this lower bound for the index in terms of the genus proved by Savo. And of course, you can ask about this for a more general situation. And okay, so the question involving now the genus is if you give a metric on this field with positive Ricci curvature, is it possible to find minimal surface with high index as well high genus? So is it possible to prove this at least for bumpy metrics using, again, a compactness result? And yeah, for a bumpy metric on a three-manifold with positive Ricci curvature, you get infinitely many minimal surfaces by Marx and Neves, and the index should go to infinity, just because this Li and Xinzhu's result on bumpy metric. Okay, this is, it's a kind of Cody Minicod's result. Cody Minicod's result is for bounded area and genus. You get the set has to be finite, and Li and Zhu is proven. They are proving that if the index is bounded, then the set has to be finite. And so using those results, we can obtain some information about the minimal surfaces produced by Marx and Neves, but of course for bumpy metrics. Okay. So the first compactness result I presented here was this Shoichain result. That is for three-dimensional case. And this result is saying that the set of minimal surface with bounded genus is compact for CK for smooth topology. Okay? If you are considering positive Ricci curvature, of course you can produce, for example, in S2 times S1 canonical sequence of torus that has no subsequence conversion. So this condition here on the positive, on the Ricci curvature is important. So as we know, this kind of compactness result is important to prove existence result. For example, just as I told you, we can prove the existence of minimal torus on S3. We can prove, using a kind of compactness result, the existence of high genus and high index minimal surfaces in three manifolds. And the question now is, how can we extend this result for high dimension? Because, of course, the Marx and Neves result is for high dimension. And so we are obtaining information about the minimal surfaces, minimal hypersurface for three manifolds, and the questions are persistent for the high dimension. And the first result of compactness is this. How can we extend this compactness result for high dimension and apply this kind of compactness result in order to obtain existence results? Okay? One very important remark here is, if you consider just a bound on the topology as for two-dimensional case, it's not possible to obtain a strong compactness result. And this is because of this example constructed by Wu Yixiang on S4. You can find in the canonical S4 a family of spheres, of course not totally geodesic spheres, with bounded area, but the sequence of spheres are converging in a very fault sense to a singular hypersurface in S4, having two singularities at antipodal points in S4. So just considering this topology, bounded topology and area, it's not enough to get this strong compactness result as for surfaces in three manifold. So, but being sharp, obtaining a result that can be seen as a generalization of the Schoen-Chain compactness result, considering a bound in the area and in the index. So somehow the index of the minimal hypersurface are a good replacement for the topology. And the result is exactly the result for the three-dimensional case. You consider positive Ricci curvature and dimension between 3 and 7. And the set of embedded minimal hypersurface with bounded area and bounded index is compact in the smooth topology. And the main idea to prove this result is the following. If you get a hypersurface that has index k, then if you consider k plus 1 balls on the ambient manifold, then this minimal hypersurface has to be stable in at least one of these k plus 1 ball. I mean, the index is bounded to the quantity of balls that you can obtain this hypersurface not stable. So you can use this together the bound in the area in order to prove that, of course, if you get the bound area, then the sequence will converge in the very fold sense up to subsequence. And then you can prove that if this sequence of minimal hypersurfaces has bounded index, then the limit will have this bounded index as well. And then you can apply a kind of, you can apply Choi-Simon estimates for the curvature in order to obtain a convergence, a nice convergence outside a finite number of points. And so after proving that you get compactness, good compactness outside a finite number of points, you can now work in order to prove that the limit will be stable. You will get good information about this limit hypersurfaces. And using the Ricci curvature is positive, you can rule out that these points are, you get these finite points where the compactness is bad. So this is the main idea behind the proof of this result. And of course, you can use this in order to get another compactness result. But before, how can we see that this result is a kind of generalization of the Schoen-Chain compactness result? We can consider this index estimate proved by Egeri Mikalev. They proved that the index is bounded above by the area and the genus. And of course, if the Ricci is positive, then you can use again these two results here in order to get area bound. And okay, if you have genus bound, you will get area bound, and then area bound and genus bound, you get the index bound, and then the compactness result, Benz result is you can apply. So this can be used in order to justify that the Benz result is a generalization of the Schoen-Chain compactness result. Okay, so using this idea, as I you can see that for at least for bumpy matrix in high dimension, or the index or the area is going to infinity. Because if index and the area are bounded, then you get a compactness result, and you can produce a bumpy, a Jacobi field on a minimal hypersurface because of this Ben Sharp result. And then, at least for bumpy matrices, we get with this Ben Sharp result some information about the minimal hypersurface produced by Marx and Neves. So, using this idea, we can extend this result for F minimal hypersurfaces in smooth metric measure spaces. Consider a manifold with a function and perturb the Ricci tensor using the Hessian of a function, F. And if this tensor here is bounded below by a positive constant, then you can prove that the set of F minimal hypersurface with a bounded F index and bounded F area is compact in smooth topology. And the idea is the same Ben used to prove his result. And very recently, Ambrosio, Carlotto, and Sharp proved that you can get some kind of compactness using another object. Because until now, we are considering genus, index, area, and Ambrosio, Carlotto, and Sharp used now the eigenvalues of the Jacobi operator in order to prove a compactness result. And they proved that, of course, their result is much more general than I'm presenting here. But if you consider the Ricci positive condition, the set of minimal hypersurface with for example, the first eigenvalue of the Jacobi operator not going to minus infinity and the area bound, then you get the set is compact. Okay? And the idea to prove this result is something like you assume, of course, if you consider the first eigenvalue of the Jacobi operator, this operator here, bounded below, then you get L2 norm bound for the second fundamental form. Of course, the area and the first eigenvalue. But this is not enough to prove the compactness. So what they are doing is they suppose that the L-infinite norm of the second fundamental form is not bounded. And then you can rescale this sequence of minimal hypersurfaces inside the ball and construct a minimal hypersurface in the Euclidean space. And this rescalement you are doing, it's good enough to get Euclidean volume growth for this minimal hypersurface in the Euclidean space. And the second fundamental form is bounded. And then you get convergence up to subsequence. And the limit has to be stable because of the condition, the first eigenvalue. And then this is enough to get that contradiction because stable in this case has to be a plane, has to be totally geodesic. But the rescalement you are considering has not zero second fundamental form. And so what is interesting here is if the limit is not stable, you get kind of information about the first eigenvalue of the Jacobi operator. But you can use this idea in order to get contradiction using another element. Actually, you get a much more general operators on the minimal hypersurface that if you bound the first eigenvalue by below, you can get a compactness result as well. And I believe that this is what we can do, considering, for example, the first eigenvalue of the Yamab operator, for example. And what is interesting is if you consider the first eigenvalue of the Yamab operator, oh, sorry, here I'm writing Yamab invariant, you can get a much more general than this result due to Ambrosio, Sharp, and Carlotto, because you get this estimate involving the first eigenvalue of the Jacobi operator and the first eigenvalue of the Yamab operator. So somehow this result can be seen as a kind of generalization of the previous result. And just to be complete, we can prove this compactness, kind of compactness result for F minimum hypersurfaces, considering the same kind of condition on the eigenvalues of the F Jacobi operator. Okay, so now this question about how can we generalize the Choi-Chain result for high dimension is somehow persistent, because Ben Sharp used the index, but it's interesting to consider a kind of something that naturally generalizes the genus and obtain a very clear, specific, natural generalization of this Choi-Chain compactness result. And one candidate that we expect it's possible to use for this is this mean conformal invariant that is defined in the following way. You consider a manifold, and you take the smallest number, positive, non-negative number satisfying this condition, and consider this n over 2 power for this number. And then you consider this number for every matrix satisfying this condition on the conformal class. And then you take the infimum, OK? This number is the same of the genus. This number is exactly 4 pi times genus minus 1 if the genus is bigger than or equal to 2, and is 0 if the genus is 0 or 1. You can use the uniformization theorem in order to see this. And another interesting thing about this mean conformal invariant is this result proved by Asman Hassan, that it's a kind of Yang-Yau result for high-dimensional manifold, not just for surfaces like this. And of course, the result is much more general. You can obtain this this estimate here for the chiasm eigenvalue of the Laplacian. This is the first eigenvalue of the Laplacian operator, okay? And so if you get a bound for this number, this mean conformal area, and the reach is positive, you can use this result in order to get an area bound. And so it's this number is generalizing the argument used for surfaces in three-dimensional manifold for hypersurfaces, high-dimensional manifold. At least using the positive reach curvature condition and a bound on this conformal number, you can get the first element that is a bound on the area. And you can get more. You can get a bound in the a bound for the L2 norm of the second fundamental form. And so this, somehow, it's a good candidate to obtain, to give us an upper bound for the index in high dimension, something like this, in terms of this high genus and area. And so a linear function of this number and the area. And of course, if the main target here is to obtain this, to prove this result. And of course, this result will give us a natural generalization for Shoichain result that is considering a bound of the genus, this conformal, mean conformal area. We can recover the compactness result just because this result will imply the index bound and the positive reach curvature condition and index bound is enough to prove that you recover compactness by Ben Sharpe's result. And so this, we expect that is it possible to obtain lower bound for the index in terms of this number as Savo has done for the canonical sphere, okay? So this is all.